All right, everybody, welcome to another episode of The Pursuit to the Plate, brought to you by Vortex Optics. This week, Joe and I are joined by guest Damon Bungard. He is with Jackson Kayaks and Orion Coolers. How are you guys doing today, Damon, Joe?
Doing great. Thanks for having me.
Doing well.
Yeah, we are excited. You're kind of, I think, the brand manager for Orion, no?
That's correct.
And I was kind of just interested in learning about the coolers, and then it kind of went from the coolers to all the stuff that you do. And I mean, you're out there every day, man. It looks like from the pictures and stuff I've seen. I mean, you're out representing the brand, obviously, but I mean, you're in it. I mean, some of the fish you've caught and the pictures you sent over, I mean, you're kind of the real deal.
Yeah, well, I appreciate that. I'm the product manager for Jackson Kayak and the brand manager of our new line of coolers, Orion Coolers. I'm on our whitewater kayak team. I'm on our kayak fishing team. I'm now on Team Orion as a hunter and general traveler, involved in the overland community. I travel, you know, I started kind of, I've always been in the outdoors. I grew up as a military brat. My father's a retired colonel. Just kind of traveling the world, and got my engineering degree at Clemson University, and I was really into rock climbing and guiding backpacking there. And then kind of evolved and just fell in love with whitewater paddling and traveled the world paddling rivers from Chile, Canada, Europe, just wherever I could get. The whitewater just drove me. And in college, I paddled for a brand then called Wave Sport out of Colorado. And at the time, it was Eric Jackson was the team manager. So EJ and I just kind of developed a relationship, and we'd see him on the road, various events. And that went on. And when I finished school and worked a lot in the aerospace and defense industry, while always kind of helping in paddle sports and still being very active hunting and fishing on the side. And then kind of a few years ago, came over full time to Jackson Kayak to be product manager, and then manage the development of now Orion Coolers as well. So my role at Jackson is as product manager is basically I take an idea and make it real.
Yeah.
Basically, I manage products from conceptual ideas through development and into production.
And make it happen, guy.
Right. So, you know, we have a great team of designers, team members giving input. Eric is still pretty much leading whitewater design. He takes team input, and we decide what product needs to be in the mix for next year. And he works very closely with David Knight, the whitewater designer, and coming up with that. Tony Lee does most of our fishing products. And then, you know, we're deciding the management team of, you know, what boat to come out with and how and what it needs to be and features wise, and developing one of Jackson Kayak's things is developing a lot of close relationships with a lot of other key made USA brands. So we design their components into our boats, and from GoPro, Nalgene, Power Pole, fishing, all the stuff, you know, the fishing kayaks are well known for people say, wow, you thought of everything. And wow, I can't believe I get all this stuff, you know, buck knives and other things with my kayak. So, so it's a great combo. I'm certainly out in the field testing a lot. I'm out testing stuff. I'm out solving problems and getting inspiration. You know, we have a lot of, you know, the Jackson name is whitewater. They're certainly the first family of the whitewater world. And we have a great kayak fishing team, over 100 people all over the world, pushing the limits of what can be done in a fishing kayak. And we're constantly getting feedback and updates. I see every consumer complaint or request that comes into customer service and look at it. And we try to weigh out what we can improve every season and what we can change and what's the next problem to be solved, both on what we had on the market last year and what we need to come out with the following year. you know, this sport of kayak fishing is just rapidly growing. It's exciting times for sure.
Yeah, huge. I mean, the past like, do what, Joe?
I say he's got one of the most comfortable kayaks to fish out of. I've fished out of quite a few kayaks, and the Jackson kayak's one of the most comfortable ones to fish out of.
Yeah, I appreciate that. You know, we just launched our new Elite Seat 2.0 and 3.0 this year, the newest version of our seat. We were kind of the first ones to basically put a lounge chair on a kayak.
Yeah. Say, recline back, man.
Right. I mean, you can adjust the seat back. You can take it off, use it as a beach chair. It's super comfortable. But more importantly, all of our fishing kayaks are designed for stand-up fishing and sight fishing.
Yes.
And getting the best vantage point and just standing from a really, really low, when your butt's on the deck kind of position is difficult. You know, sitting on the floor and going to a standing position is not easy.
No.
For a fishing kayak, for standing, it's not what you want. So by raising it up, you're really engaging those power muscles in your legs, and you can easily sit up and sit back down. And we include a stand assist strap to help you do that. But having that advantage of being able to stand and see and cast and see fish before you cast at them, is a huge advantage. And, you know, fishing kayaks for a long, long time were just recreational kayaks. People would add a couple of rod holders to and call it a fishing kayak. And that wasn't really what was needed. And finally, we said, okay, this is myself and others were saying, screaming, saying, this is not a fishing kayak. A fishing kayak needs to be this. And that's what we made. And we kind of started with the Kusa, a river fishing model, which is still very popular for us. It came out, you know, as a river whitewater company. We had guys, you know, I've been fishing with a seven piece fly rod in back of my whitewater kayak for years, going on float plane drops up in the edge of Labrador and paddling for a week back to the coast of, you know, class five whitewater with a fly rod in the back. And those kind of getting a kayak into places like that and on rivers just was a nice fit. So we started with the Kusa, and now we have a model for every fishing style species you could think of. You want to go long distance, short distance. You want more stability, less stability, rivers, lakes, oceans, you name it. Big fish, small fish, lots of features, not that many features. We have a fishing kayak that will fit your needs. So it's great. And, you know, fishing kayaks now you're seeing power pulls and, you know, down vision sonar systems and same kind of great comforts and luxuries you see on
a boat,
super expensive bass boats on kayaks. And just the functionality is wonderful. Get the advantages of getting them into places people just can't fish and getting on, you know, just like any big game or any other fish, you know, real trophies are that way because they have a chance to get old and not be pressured. And, you know, kayaks just let you get to places that other people just don't fish.
Yeah, for sure.
Back in the areas that my boat won't take me.
Absolutely. I mean, we're seeing, you know, that this year we came out with the Realtree Kilroy, our new duck hunting model, and the Max 5 with Realtree. The Kilroy, the base Kilroy is a fishing model. It's kind of one of my babies. It was kind of took inspiration from drift boats and flat skiffs as a sit inside kayak, fishing kayak. And we came out with a duck hunting version of it. We're working with Realtree on that. And the same advantages for kayak fishing apply with that boat. I mean, it's, you know, when we use it in Vermont, for instance, with my buddy, he's got kayak racks built onto his motorized duck boat just so we can get it up a number of miles more than you want to paddle in a day. But then we get into the kayaks and drag through beaver dams and drag back into back potholes where the birds just aren't pressured at all. And just have a ball. So those same type of advantages for hunting, accessing big game, accessing islands and back into swamps where you can put your tree stand in and get in there and get out where you can never get a motorized boat. There's those advantages.
Yeah.
For hunting, sure. As well as there is for fishing.
For sure. I agree 100%, man. And like you were saying, too, I don't know if it's just that I'm following more folks that are getting into that side of the sport, but I would agree 100% just in the past, I would say probably 3 years, it seems to me that that market has just exploded. Like, there, I see so many more people. I mean, there, as to where, okay, for Orion coolers, for instance, you know, they're actually, in all the cooler companies, like, everybody is marketing their smaller coolers for fishing kayaks. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, it's just the whole, you know, the whole kayak industry, like, the whole, all aspects of the sport is just, I mean, it I'd say, it to me, it looks like it's grown almost 100%.
Yeah, it's tough to put a exact finger on how the overall industry has grown. Kayak fishing is certainly, I'd say, is growing by leaps and bounds. Yeah. You know, I think during the recession, I think a lot of people started looking towards ways to do more things closer to home. Instead of spending lots of money on vacations, they started looking, what can I do more here than I maybe mm-hmm. wasn't doing before? And, you know, maybe there's a lake nearby or a river, and no, they don't own an expensive bass boat, but like, you know, they don't really utilize the lake, but they're, you know, if I get a kayak, I can. Yep. So I think people did some more looking at closer to home. Gas prices were going up. People wanted to travel less. What can I do more closer to home? I think that helped in certain regions. And I certainly think, you know, it's fishing kayak popularity has grown. People just realize, you know, I can't store, insure, pay for the gas of these boats, but you know, I can get in a fishing kayak and keep it in my garage and load it on my roof by myself, and get into waters where there aren't boat ramps or where there are boat ramps, either way. And it's just a certainly different intimate style of fishing. You know, you're not going to go to one spot and then motor 15 miles to the next kind of spot. You learn your spots you need to go.
Oh yeah.
It's a great exercise and alternative. And it's certainly not a replacement. It just lets you fish differently. It lets you really sneak up on fish and use stealth versus covering ground. You know, I like fly fishing for carp, and carp are, you know, excellent hearing and super spooky. But you can get up. I've gotten up to where I'm casting within. If you line up and watch your shadow from the sun lining up to where you're within 10 feet behind them and just kind of cast over their nose. Mm-hmm. Fly. So it's and then you're all on for a big long sleigh ride. So same thing with bonefish. You know, I was just down in the Keys catching bonefish from the kayak on the fly. You know, that's a traditionally spooky fish, and you know, we're getting in close and getting them on the fly. So,
and primarily, I mean, from what we've kind of talked, you would prefer fly fish, right?
Yeah, I fly fish. Pretty much, unless I'm filming a TV show and the producer says cast with a spin or a bait caster. Other than that, I'm pretty much fly fishing. Actually, I just did an episode of Fishing University with Charlie Ingram and Ray Brazier. They were all Ian, Eric Jackson and Ray. And I was fishing with Ray, and Eric was with Charlie. And they were all three bait casting, and I was fly fishing for bass in Florida. And I ended up catching biggest bass and most bass.
There you go, out. Man.
It worked out.
See, I've not had the privilege yet of fly fishing, and I think that's one of the things. If there's a fishing experience out there that you need to try over everything else, I would think that would probably be it.
You'll be the first time you try it.
It's good to get a lesson. Don't get it's easy to get to have bad technique and not understand and get frustrated. I think if you have a good first experience, like anything, if it's a whitewater kayaking, bad first anything first experience is going to turn you off. So,
oh yeah.
But you know, once you understand that with a fly rod, the line is casting the lure, not your rod, and learning to load the line on the rod. To get the fly to move right, and it's a different stroke and casting technique for sure. And once that's down, you know, there's a lot of fishing entertainment and pleasure that just comes from casting. You know, fishing in itself can be boring. We all know this, but it certainly has that potential. But fly fishing, certainly, if you're an appreciator of the process, it's pretty, it's more challenge, more reward.
Yeah, I think so. That is a lot more intimate too. The whole thing just seems kind of like that's how.
Yeah, and that mold is changing largely too. You know, people that used to think fly fishing was trout. And it's not the case anymore. You know, I have musky flies a foot long in my fly box. You know, I have flies for carp, musky, bass, pike,
wow,
tarpon, I mean, saltwater fish, I mean, snook. I just caught a wonderful barracuda on that key strip, some photos floating around of that. So, I mean, pretty much any species, somebody's trying to catch on the fly nowadays.
I think you had sent over a lot of those picks, like you were just talking about, you know, the tarpon and
mm-hmm.
those. I mean, it was impressive.
I guess you can incorporate fly fishing to ice fishing. I have ice fly fishing rods on my ice gear.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a little hard to stand 50 feet away and get the fly into that little hole on the ice. It's something you can do when you're really bored on the lake.
I just like it for the straight line effect. Because I have a straight line down, I have no twist in my line. And fly fishing in general is more like a hand-to-hand combat with the fish.
Oh, yeah, it's all about the fight, you know, getting a rod on that flimsy stick and controlling it and getting it in. You know, it's all of it, really. It's the process of getting it, figuring out what they're going to eat, getting it to eat, and then landing it. It's certainly the game is far from over once it's hooked. You know, getting out on the fishing kayaks, as they have evolved, is kind of the similar inspiration behind Orion Coolers. You know, as users and getting out and spending a lot of time in the field, going on long trips, isolated trips. You know, there's now a lot of great premium coolers on the market. They do what they're supposed to do well. They keep things cold for a long time. And, you know, with the expertise we have and capability we have in our own facility in-house, we mold everything and make everything in Sparta, Tennessee.
Mm-hmm.
It just came with the coolers. It just came down to, you know, the cooler can be more than it is now. We can do a lot more with this. So you'll see a lot of the same kind of innovations and inspirations in the coolers that you see in the fishing kayaks, whether it's track systems, so you can put fishing rods or phone holders or GoPro mounts or whatever you want to customize your cooler. Just like our kayaks have it, they're built into the coolers.
You guys can just get on the website. It's orioncoolers.com, right?
That's correct. That's
it. And you can go through and just look at all the different things you can do with the coolers. And like you just stated, rod holders, drink holders, GoPro mounts. Isn't there some kind of deal to where it can't get stolen out of like a lock thing or something?
Yeah. So every one of the other differentiators we have is every corner is a bottle opener and a tie down point. So and it's also your locking point. Mm-hmm. So you'll see these aluminum corners on all four corners, and there's a slit kind of in the middle of each short side, which lets you attach webbing or a simple cam strap to hold it down to your roof rack or back of your truck, whatever, your boat.
Mm-hmm.
And that's pretty standard, but having these corner tie down points is a little bit different. And then having them be bottle openers is totally unique. And so you never look around for a bottle opener again. You just pull the bottle out and there you go, pop the cap. But then also the way that our cooler locks is different. So it's common for coolers to have holes in the lid and base, and you put a padlock through it, and you can lock it then with a cable to the bed of your truck, to your boat, or to whatever you want. But then that prevents you from being able to open and close the cooler while it's locked. So we designed ours to work around a master type shackle lock or standard flexible gun lock. And you have the option of either locking all the way through the lid and base, or you'll notice a small gap over that bottle opener corner, and you can just put the lock around the base and still be able to open and close the lid.
So you can lock the cooler in theory, but still use it.
Right. So instead of losing its usage when it's locked, you can you have the option of doing that, of just locking the base to whatever you want, or doing both. You can lock the base off one corner and then lock the whole thing shut off the other.
Yeah. No, they're, I mean, they're definitely neat, and the patterns are similar, like the kayaks, like
right.
you've taken.
So, you know, Jackson Kayaks, well known for having a lot of fun, cool, unique colors and banded patterns. And so we're unique in our ability to mold the same things into our coolers. So every one of our coolers matches one of our fishing kayak colors. And we'll have more colors coming online as the years go on. But having those unique banded patterns versus just plain old solids is certainly a distinctive aspect of Orion coolers. It's pretty fun. The small size.
They're wicked looking, man.
Yeah, thanks. The,
I mean, they really are.
They're totally awesome. Unique. It's we've gotten a lot of good reactions. The you know, we just, you know, we're such a new brand, it's ramping up and things are happening so fast. We just started shipping the 65s, the 65 quart size in December, and the 25 and 45 quart just started shipping last week. So and the 25s fit inside the backs of every one of our fishing kayaks behind the seat. So, you know, the 29-45 make great standing platforms, smaller game, smaller fish. The 65 and then the upcoming 85, which will be out in April, better for larger, bigger game, bigger fish, longer. You know, if you're going to go to a hunting camp and you got guys need ice for their drinks for a week, you know, you can go with larger sizes, and, day trips and weekend trips and smaller ones. You know, other innovations we have, it's the standing pad on top with the Cool Orion logo comes standard on all the coolers. You'll see on the inside a unique tray. It's not a wireframe where small items can pass through. It's a solid thermoform plastic tray. And on the side of that is a light system called the Amp One from Princeton Tech, another made in USA company out of New Jersey. Makes really good waterproof rugged lighting systems, headlamps and different lights for our military and consumers. And that fits in a little sleeve on the side of the tray. So you can just twist it on and light up the interior contents of your tray. And you slide the tray back and forth to see what's inside. Or you can take it out. It's got a bottle opener in it. That makes five.
And, just, and, just in case everybody needs to open a beer at the same time.
That's right. Six packs. pretty soon we'll find that sixth spot. And or you can take the cone off of it and use it as a nice high power LED light around camp. So a lot of function and useful there. So.
There's just some things that like I mean, instead of fumbling around like a flashlight or a headlamp or something, because I mean everybody's done it either when they're camping, like either like a like whitetail camp or elk camp or whatever you may be, even fishing, trying to fumble around through a cooler while you're holding a flashlight, digging with one hand, right. And then you're trying, I mean, little things like that. It's like, okay, yeah, okay.
Right. It's a lot of the devils in the details, you know, and that's what we're big on. And, you know, Jackson Kayak, it's not just about having a feature for this and a feature for that and a feature for this. It's about having all the features that work together so that, you know, you have, when you have a fish landed, you have somewhere to stick your paddle to get your hands free. When you have a fish hooked, you can shove it under the paddle holder and the bungee in the front, and the rod holder's in the right spot, or your tools in the right spot, or other things are in the right places so that they all work together in unison. It's not just a standalone feature here or there.
Yeah, I think everybody's been in a situation where you're fumbling around jacking with stuff, and definitely on the water makes it tough. Right. You know,
it makes you lose fish, and it makes stuff in the water, and it's not fun.
I've done that before. We got a when we crappie fish, there's a boat we go in that, you know, I got a small, low stinger that we'll take out. It's like a duck boat style, but you know, if you got a boat that just has one live well, you know, we'll take and we'll like cut one of the fins or something like that. That way we can keep, you know, if you get pulled over by water patrol or something, they'll want to know, okay, well, whose fish is whose, you know, and if they want to, they can be real sticklers on that stuff, so that you have to find a way to mark your fish and junk. And I don't know how many times you're sitting there trying to fumble around and mark your fish or whatever, and then off jumps off the boat. You're like, damn, I've lost a couple 14-inch crappie that way. That sucks.
Yep.
But, yeah, the less you have to worry about, you know.
Right. It's a safety and pleasure thing, really. You know, things can happen, especially if you're kayak fishing on a river or other places where you're moving. You know, you want to make sure you know spatial awareness is pretty important.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that everything's working together.
Yeah, for sure. 100%. Oh, goodness. The coolers, you pretty much stayed. You got 25, 45, 65, and the upcoming 85. And I think everything ships now minus the 85, which comes out in April, correct?
That's correct. We'll have the mold in for the 85 in about 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. And then we'll, you know, our team will dial it in and get it molding right and get the cooling fixtures and everything built and everything all straightened out. And then should be, if everything moves forward as planned, it'll be shipping out the door in April.
Now, if you were to tell people, I mean, you kind of broke it down. Like, I would say if you're going to go on a big game hunt, you know, if you're going out to Colorado, mm-hmm. To, you know, chase elk or whatever it may be, you'd probably want to go 85 and then, you know, definitely at that point, take a couple.
Yeah, you know, really, if you're going, a lot of it boils down to whether or not you do boning or not. Mm-hmm. Before you're home. But,
yeah,
you know, when we designed the coolers, we didn't, one of the unique aspects to our coolers is the number does truly correlate to the storage capacity.
Mm-hmm.
So 85 quarts is 85 quarts, 65 quarts is 65 quarts of storage capacity.
Mm-hmm.
And we designed the exterior dimensions around a lot of common locations and common storage places and just common things that go inside it. So for instance, you can stand a wine bottle up vertically in the 45. You can lay down cases of water, or in the 25, you can put a beer sideways or stood up straight.
Mm-hmm.
You can put different cases of 24 cases of cans, different orientations and different size coolers for interior capacity, but also externally, we sized around common dimensions of four-wheeler racks. We sized around the heights of tonneau covers on trucks so that if you have one under a tonneau cover and concealed, it still slides in and out. Yep. We sized it around common back seats. You know, the 65, if you go to, you know, on ryancoolers.com, I do a lot of writing and storytelling and kind of photos and articles myself. And mm-hmm. there's a multi-part series going on right now on the Orion Coolers website. And part one is kind of my planning and traveling up to a caribou hunt with my father in Alaska. Mm-hmm. And you can see the 65 there was designed. So, you know, Suburbans are pretty popular for everything from tailgating to hunting and bringing a crew of folks. And it was designed so that when the third row seating is folded down, you can still put it sideways in the back of the Suburban. Those are all things that we looked at when it came to figuring out our dimensions.
A ton of thought goes into it, basically. I mean, yeah, it's not just, okay, here, this is going to, yeah.
And you can't fit everything, you know, but I drive a four-door Wrangler, you know, the 45 was designed to fit sideways in the back of my back when my back seats are up.
Mm-hmm.
The 25s are designed to fit through common door spacings in car doors to get in back seats versus the very, very back.
Mm-hmm.
So, and the kayaks. So we try to incorporate all that. But so yeah, the guys, you know, guys going west, you know, 80, I would suggest for bigger game like that, an 85, maybe two if you're not going to debone it.
Mm-hmm.
The field, you know, the 65 is more than enough for a whitetail, even on the bone.
Mm-hmm.
45s are great for deboned hogs and whitetails. You could easily do two deboned and in a 65, maybe even two boned, mm-hmm. boned out, depending on how big the whitetails were. So, you know, that we've gotten some requests already from, you know, rafting companies and some of the bigger moose outfits and elk outfits asking for an even larger volume. So, you know, we're considering that now already for 2016.
The Orion tank.
Yeah, the Orion coffin.
Yeah, no kidding, man. You start getting up over 85 quarts. I've got a 75. I think the biggest cooler I own now is a 75 quart.
Mm-hmm.
And you get it full, I can lug it around.
Yeah, it becomes two-man jobs for sure, but full of game, it gets really
heavy. Uh-huh. Yeah, real quick. I mean, it's nice. Soup, you can have, it's like basically an outdoor fridge.
Right.
But holy smokes, do not try to manhandle one by yourself.
No, it's got hernia written all over it.
Yeah, comes with a warning right on it. Do not pick up alone.
Guys, you know, I want a 125, and I want, you know, full of elk, and, you know, that I can get in the back out of the back of my truck myself. And I'm just like, unless you're doing more roids than I am, you're not going to be able to do that.
Yeah, and remind me not to make you mad.
Right. It's yeah, meat's dense. So
yeah, for sure. For sure. So what we're talking about, filling up coolers, man. Let's say while we're on the big game right now, kind of to stick with it, like what out of all the big game, what would you say that you predominantly, I would say, go after or pursue the most?
Well, I'd say just based on where I live now in Tennessee, it's whitetails, just because that's what's here in my immediate vicinity. There's some public ground. Actually, if you go to the Ryan Cooler site, you'll see a story I wrote on Western style backpack hunting here in Tennessee. And that article kind of focused on, you know, it's typical out west to have to hike miles and pack your game out on your back to get it out. Whereas East Coast hunters, that's not typically what they're doing. You know, they're either parking their truck and walking to their stand or getting on a four wheeler and getting close. And game usually gets drug out whole.
Yeah.
Or gutted. But bringing it out in pieces is just not part of the culture here. And I just, you know, I like that Western hunting style, but I also like solitude. And there was, you know, there was a canyon not far from my house here on the plateau. And then when I moved here, some of the locals were like, oh yeah, nobody hunts in there. Deer just get old and die in there. And I was like, those are two counter conflicting opinions in my world.
Yeah.
So I started hiking down in there. Sure enough, you have to hike down, you know, 1,000 feet, and you have to cross a river and you go in a few miles. But I had total solitude and had a wonderful time hunting and was able to harvest a nice whitetail, some cool palmation on his rack out of there. And so, you know, whitetails, my folks live in Georgia, on the coast in Savannah. I usually go down to hunt with dad and down there a couple times a year and for hogs and for deer and in South Carolina. And, here in Tennessee, this is probably the places I've lived now getting into the better whitetail areas. Now we just moved from Vermont here last year, and Vermont isn't well known for, a lot of whitetails are very big whitetails. It's, you know, people are usually happy just to see deer when they go to deer camp there. And so I didn't whitetail hunt a lot up there, but I did go, have the pleasure of going for whitetails in Ontario with a friend from Vermont. And, you know, a good buddy up there is really into tracking deer in the snow. And he'd been telling me for years, but I needed to go to Ontario with him to track whitetails in the fresh snow. And, right before I was going to leave, it's finally, okay, yes, let's do it. I went up there, about a 30-hour drive from Vermont, all the way up to northwestern Ontario, and just had an absolute ball. And it was literally, you don't hunt the deer, you hunt the track. And you get on all these public forest roads, and you drive and drive, and you look for deer tracks crossing these trails. And when you find a good one that's got good spacing and good size, you just get out, park the truck, and you start walking. You follow it until you find that deer. And it's a heck of an exciting way to hunt. You don't always find them. Sometimes you do. In my case, tracked a buck about 2.5 miles. And as my friend Harper, and went through some really, really thick, went through a clear cut area that was regrown with pine trees, crawled through some really thick brush near, and just got into this insanely, just blowdowns and super dense. It was like just being in a wooded sound room, and you could see where multiple deer had kind of milled around. And then there were two buck tracks leaving this area, and you picked one, I picked the other. And we were about, 40 yards apart, and I hear a rustling. And I'm just saying to myself, wow, Harper's being really loud. And then I'm saying to myself, wait a minute, there's no way I can hear him. And then I see this tree kind of in front of me move, and this buck just kind of jumped through it and 10 yards in front of me. And he's standing there, just huge rack, just standing there looking at me. And I hunt a lot with a Marlin 4570 guide gun. And
yeah,
and I'm pulling it up, and it's about 6 degrees out, and safety's frozen.
Oh no.
And I'm pulling it up to my head and pressing with my thumb on the safety at the same time, and it won't come loose. And I'm just thinking to myself, you know, just think something, something. And that's like, maybe cycle around, maybe the vibration will shock the safety free. And sure enough, I cycled around while he's looking at me, felt it slide, kept bringing it up, and all I saw, and the scope is still on 9 power, I think. All I saw was, you know, nose rack and a white patch under his throat, and I put it on that white patch and pulled the trigger, and he collapsed, didn't take a step, and the big tree of snow fell on him, and that was it.
It's funny how that works too. The scope, like, you, it's yeah. always on 9 power,
right?
Like, why right. couldn't it have been on 3.5? You know, right.
So that was an amazing hunt. That photo of dragging that buck out won Sitka's whitetail
wow.
photo contest. Impressive. So you might see that in the next Eastman's and other ads coming up. Mm-hmm. And then if you follow Sitka Gear's photo, they it won their number 2, the different photo, but you can kind of see me with that buck, just in an amazing surrounding of snow. Wooded snow, won their number 2 photo of the year on Instagram.
Wow.
So... Yeah, so the back to you saying whitetails, just, you know, as the East Coast, living on the East Coast, it's just predominantly what I get. I really like bear hunting too. I've taken a bear in Quebec and in Vermont, where you can't bait. So getting a bear in Vermont's pretty hard. I spent 3 years sleeping on this mountain, finding the bear trails, and so I go out sometimes before sunrise and home after dark, and just find a rock ledge and spend all day on it trying to find them when they'd pass by this trail. Mm-hmm. Was able to eventually, after 3 years, take a bear there. And hog hunting, stalking hogs in the swamps, one of my favorite things to do with a bow or a rifle. Just trying to find a freshly used wallow in the old uncut cypress swamps in the south, and then trying to follow the mud drips when they leave a wallow, and just follow the mud drips so you can find a hog.
For as many of them as there are, you know, you'd think it'd be easier than it is.
It's quite difficult. and, you know, you see all this stuff about how hard these hogs are overrun at various places, and they come charging into feeders. You know, these places aren't, they don't have any feeders. These hogs have been there a while, since Columbus landed, basically. Mm-hmm. And it's quite a challenge.
If they don't want to be seen, they're pretty good about getting the hell out.
They bed down in the thickest stuff you can think of, and they will let you get past them or ride on them before they let you know they're there.
Mm-hmm.
So I do quite enjoy, and I love cooking wild hog. It's one of my favorite meats for sure. Shoot a nice 100-pound sow, and you're pretty good.
Bacon.
And you know, I love traveling out west to hunt. You know, one of my most memorable trips, you know, just happened. I was able to guide my father on a self-guided drop hunt for caribou in Alaska. These articles I'm writing right now. I'm kind of telling that story on the Orion Coolers website. And that was, you know, he and I driving all the way up to Dalton Highway, the haul road, 400 miles of dirt, getting on Super Cubs and flying out into the Brooks Range on the tundra and picking a spot and getting put down, and take your bags out of the plane, wheels up, and then there you are. You're just standing there.
Hope everything goes well.
Yeah, you know, we came in everything. You know, Pat flew in all of our food, all of our gear, and rigged up, and were able to take 4 bulls and, you know, packed them all off the tundra and back to camp. And it was a pretty amazing trip. I try to get out for elk each year, friends' places in Idaho. Do some bear hunting there as well. You know, so I like to get around. Just went on, was just in Texas. I quite enjoy going after javelina with the recurve or bow or compound in West Texas. I just think they're cool little native U.S. critters that are a ton of fun to try to stalk close with a bow.
Yes, that's one thing. As far as hog hunting goes, like that one, if I had to pick the first, that I'd try to go after that number
one.
Yeah,
I mean, javelina are great. You know, people think they're pigs, and they're not. They're more closely related to hippos than they are pigs.
Mm-hmm.
And they're native, and they're wild little animals. They don't get very big. 60 pounds is a big one. 80 pounds and it'd be huge. And they have this really neat kind of social order, and they this crazy musk gland halfway up the middle of their back, and they scent each other, and they scent their dens, and people call them skunk pigs because of this gland.
But oh yeah,
they're just neat, you know. They have they lack certain organs that pigs have and different toe shapes, but they, you know, they're designed to be nomads of the desert, and they eat prickly pear, and they're really cold sensitive. But they're, you know, the fact that you can call them and they'll come charging with a distress call, and they'll flare up like a porcupine. It's like they're half porcupine, half pig, half rat. I don't know, half miniature hippo, I guess. They're just cool, I don't know what it is about them, I just think they live in cool places. I love mountain hunting, and I go near Big Bend up in the mountains of Texas, and it's like bighorn sheep hunting, only you can afford it.
I know it. That they're wily little cousins too, man. Like,
yeah,
I've seen Ornella go after them a few times, and then a couple other folks, man. It just, like you said, you got to be careful processing, obviously, but I think that'd be a fun one. Just the terrain, like you're talking about, it's not, you know, it's a chase.
People hunt them in senderos and in the more traditional South Texas areas, and you know, they're usually hunting road cuts there in the senderos, but you know, in West Texas, it's wide open country. You're looking at mule deer and javelina, and you're glassing a mile away, you know,
yeah,
1,000 feet up. So
cover a lot of ground.
Certainly different styles of hunting depending on where you go in Texas. But that was the last hunt that I went on. And then I was able, while on that trip, to a new Orion team member at Cow Creek Ranch. He's got a low fence operation in Texas, which is pretty rare. To have free range, and we went out and got a Mufflin ram with him. So that was that was last week.
So. Wow, man. Just all over the place. Everybody can like live vicariously through this episode of trying to hunt everything that pretty much anybody could ever want to hunt.
Yeah, I like to, it's certainly, you know, I like to get in the woods. It's my time. It's making memory, like collecting memories for sure. That's what I do.
Oh yeah, some good ones too. What's the one thing that, I guess, if you haven't had a chance to go after it, like what's your unicorn to go try?
Well, I never kill a unicorn. They're so rare. But there's a lot of things. I think pretty much anything hunting with my dad, going on a nice trip, wilderness trip, would rank up there. I'd love to take him on a moose hunt. That's pretty high on my list. Personally, between mountaineering and ice and rock climbing, and I love mountains and I love rivers. I'd love one day to be able to sheep hunt. I don't care the species. I wouldn't even care if I was just filming or packing the animal off. Just
be a part of it.
Being on a sheep hunt. I just love being in the mountains. So that's one thing I like, just by where I go javelina hunting, and, you know, I'm in the mountains. That definitely ranks pretty high. I'd like to continue going. I do quite enjoy caribou hunting. I've gone down in Quebec and Alaska, and I just think they're amazing animals. They have, you know, you think about them, they don't have a home territory. They're basically, they're born and they walk until they die. And yep. There is no, this is their territory. It's, unless you want to consider the Arctic their territory, but
very nomadic.
Yeah, extremely. And, you know, they cover, and just, so it's in that sense, you know, it's an animal that's very well adapted and just very, unique in that sense. There's no home range. Those are right now, I think, and I've never gone after pronghorn, which is another animal that, you know, you can kind of see what I appreciate, the ones I'm describing. But You know, pronghorn is a, you know, uniquely North American big game species that is, you know, adapted and perfectly for its environment. And, you know, it's so fast because it used to have, you know, predators in the Ice Age no longer exist. But it's a unique one for North America that I've never actually been able to go after. So I'd love to try to get a pronghorn one day as well.
I'm hoping that I actually get to the pronghorn this fall from Montana. I applied last year and I didn't draw because it's hard, but I'm going to go applying for mule deer. And if I don't get the mule deer, I'm going to apply for the antelope too, which I might even just apply for the antelope as well, just because it gives you, it's kind of like a lottery. And the more you apply, the more chances you get. So, but that, my main goal is to try to get to Montana and hunt pronghorn, but I'm not going to turn down mule deer either.
No, I wouldn't.
Yeah, no.
It's kind of a combo hunt too. You know, a lot of people will go
mule deer. Yes. And I think Joe, Are you going up there? Are you going to try for this fall too, Joe, for the mule deer? Or are you?
I am.
I think we're both. One of our guys, Matt Anderson, he does like the Euro mounts and stuff like that. But he's from Montana. And did the guys like? You can get on our website, and he's got some blog posts up there. But, you know, I've said this in a couple other episodes, like the guy, you start off talking to him and you're like, man, he really thinks highly of his dad and stuff. And then you actually start hearing some of the stories and seeing the pictures to back him up. And wow, I mean, this guy, his dad, like, and Matt themselves, like they have religiously hunted mule deer their whole lives. And like his dad's taken
65 straight years.
65 straight years?
64 straight years, something like that.
And taking a buck.
That's impressive.
In Montana. So, I mean, it's, yeah, the guy, I mean, it's going to be an experience for both Joe and I, like, just to hunt with some folks like that in Montana. So, you know, I of course, want the pronghorn. You know, I want to go after them. But, man, I don't know. It's, on the other hand, if I don't get it, then, you know, mule deer it is, and hopefully I get one or the other, you know, but not this year, for sure next year, like, I think it's pretty much a guaranteed shoe-in. But
yeah, I think we're looking at too, and this fall, trying to maybe do a pronghorn hunt. And I think Wyoming's, I think, was over the counter. One of the, a couple states you can get over the counter. I don't think the trophy quality is quite as good, but
yeah,
I think Wyoming's over the counter. We were looking there.
Yeah, and that's almost, you know, did the whole Colorado, because you start talking, you get a combo tag. And hell, I could go to Colorado and try to elk hunt. And that, I mean, you talk about everything, like, that'd be my one thing, like, to hunt elk. Like, I've never got to do it.
It's and a lot. It's turkey hunting on crack. It's a lot of fun when they're responding to a call.
Yeah, exactly. And the meat, I mean, elk and caribou is probably about the best game meat, I think, that you can get.
Yeah, I rank, you know, we don't buy a lot of meat in my freezer right now. I got alligator, caribou, bear, hog, deer. I rattle off a whole bunch of meat, but caribou certainly ranks. Their racks are nice, but they also, their meat ranks very high. If not, I'm not top of my list. You know, I try to describe elk as a really high quality beef almost, and then caribou is like the best venison you can imagine
ever.
Yeah.
It's real. They're both just, you know, that's kind of our whole thing. Like the name of the podcast, The Pursuit to the Plate. Ultimately, at the end of the day, you know, we take our, it's kind of like what we're doing now. You know, it's not just about the hunt, but everything involved. And then you can sit down and actually share the hunt in all sorts of different ways, stories while you're cooking it, while you're eating it, while you're, you know, sharing it with everybody, you know, and
absolutely.
There's just a level of intimacy, I think, and camaraderie, you know, the whole brotherhood's kind of cheesy, but it's kind of there in a sense, man. That's, I mean, we all have one common bond. It's the outdoors, and it's hunting, it's fishing. And
oh, yeah. You know, people sitting around a table enjoying the fruits of their labor is not a foreign thing or an unnatural thing. I think it's a good thing.
No, and I've met some really good folks. Like, we just had Hank Shaw on not too long ago. I don't know if you're familiar with him or not. But he wrote Duck, Duck, Goose and Hunt, Gather, Cook. And he's been on Meat Eater, I think. once or twice. I'm not sure. But he was, you know, professional cook, you know, turned into the outdoors quite some time ago. And the guy, he just things that you run into from the hunting and cooking aspect of it, you know, I think you just meet people that, yeah, I don't know. You're never going to meet the kind of people in a pool league. You know what I mean? Right. That you're going to meet in the outdoors. Not saying a pool league's bad. I'm just saying that generally speaking, I think that we devote a lot.
Oh yeah. And so much hard work goes into it so often, you know. Yeah. Hunting's not easy. And it involves a lot of work, a lot of time, a lot of commitment.
Thick skin.
Yeah. And you know, people often say, "Oh, think how much money you must save by having all that meat in your freezer." I wish that were the case, but unfortunately, you know, license costs, travel costs, everything else. If you're looking at it that way, it's not. You know, when you look at it just pure pound for pound, sure, it might be cheaper than buying it in the grocery store, but it's all worth it. It's all why we do what we do.
Exactly.
You know, on my counter right now, there's a pack of Alaska salmon thawing for dinner. So, we've been snacking on. We had, you know, the caribou. We dropped it at, I packed it off in game bags and flew it out, and then had it processed in Anchorage for us at Alaska Sausage and Seafood, and we had them, you know, smoke some of it into like Slim Jim jerky sticks and the steaks and other more traditional cuts, you know. But like the Slim Jim sticks make great. I snack on them when I'm on the tree stand for whitetails now.
Oh, for sure.
And they make great appetizers with some nice cheese for we have salmon tonight. So it's enjoying what you bring home. So nothing wrong with that. Uh-huh. Sharing it with your friends and family is a very good aspect of hunting, no doubt about it.
Oh, for sure. And I kind of try to take it to a whole nother level. I pretty much process everything myself.
Mm-hmm.
And
as much as possible.
It's hard sometimes just because of the time involved. And yep. I'm fortunate that, you know, on one hand, not traveling around doing it all the time, I'm not overwhelmed with,
right.
There's no way in hell I can do this. I just don't have time, you know? So, I mean, I go out, I get a deer or two, all the ducks and geese, my turkeys and all that. But yeah, that's, I like that, you know, that.
Yeah. I enjoy, you know, processing it myself. You know, my wife's, you know, I don't have to worry about silver skin and fat and things that don't need to be, you know, real picky. You know, some people get turned off from game quickly if you know, it's not processed properly.
Exactly.
So I like having that control myself and making sure it's handled well and it's not mistreated. You know, whitetails and hogs at home do all myself. You know, when I travel, like, you know, in Alaska, you know, we ended up shipping home 300 pounds of processed afterwards.
Holy smokes. Holy
cow. So, that's, you know, so, but there has been no way I would have been able
to
test that on the road like that.
Uh-uh.
But I try to do it all as much as possible as by myself, except for sausage. I haven't quite figured out sausage yet. So usually what I'll do is there's a really good in Savannah. There's a really good, place, so Geechee meat and sausage that will do really nice Italian sausage, and usually I'll shoot a dough or something down there and just have sausage for the year made from that dough.
Okay. Yeah. Sausages, that's kind of what I've recently been born into. I tackled this last year and I was in the same boat.
Mm-hmm.
We kind of went over it with Hank Shaw on the, what was that, episode 14?
Yep.
I think, but yeah, sausage making. There were two books that just did it for me, and Charcuterie, which is Michael Ruhlman, he kind of came out and wrote that book, and he was kind of in cahoots with another guy, and I'm shooting myself for drawing a blank on it. Is it Pullman? Something like that. I can't remember, Joe, but that was a great book for recipes. And then Hank Shaw has some fantastic recipes in that Hunt Gather Cook. It's one of those things to where you have to have the proper equipment,
right?
And I was doing Exactly, and it does. And if you have the proper equipment, see, as to where I was trying to do everything with my KitchenAid, mm-hmm. and, you know, grinding it, it could go faster, which we just recently teamed up with Western Products. So, you know, we're going to be set now, and it's great because the meat grinders, and to have, you need to have, and the best thing I can recommend is have item-specific products for what you're doing. So your meat grinder needs to be a meat grinder.
Yeah, I've been looking at the Western ones. I'm in the same boat right now. Using my wife's KitchenAid.
and it works okay for grinding. Yeah. I'm going to tell you right now, for sausage stuffing, it is a nightmare and a half. Like, there's a 50 to 75% chance that your meat's going to, the fat's going to render. And it's just going to go to, it, as Hank called it, it's going to turn into cat food. Mm. And, you know, wet cat food, not dry. We're talking nasty. And it still tastes good, but it's just a horrible consistency.
Horrible texture. Yeah.
Exactly. You don't get over it. But, you know, have a dedicated grinder, which I think Weston's, they have that Realtree 650-watt, which, you know, fairly affordable. I think it's like a couple $100, $170. And, dude, you can grind, God, I think, 14 pounds of meat in like 15 minutes, if that.
Uh-huh.
And then they have the stuffer, like a dual speed. That's the other thing, like, recommended for a stuffer. Have an actual dedicated stuffer. And try to keep everything stainless steel if possible. But like that right there, bam. And then you can get some base recipes to go off of. Like the charcuterie dude, he's got every sausage you could think of in that book. Italians, Knox, brats, kielbasses, yada, 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 yada. And I think Hank in the Hunt Gather Cook, dude, he's got, what, snack sticks, Joe? Kielbasses.
Snack sticks, kielbasses. I think he has Polish sausages.
Polish,
in there.
A couple different German types. I mean, it's one, like, he explained it, and this is going to be kind of a contest we have, but he explained sausage making is similar to jazz in a sense. You know, it's the same song. Or same 26 songs or 25 songs done 437 different ways, you know?
Yeah.
So, but yeah, man, that's my thing. Like, that's my new, I guess, birth into the processing is I've made my own brats, I think, the past couple go-arounds, man, and they've been phenomenal.
Good.
Like deer brats. So, yeah, now snack sticks and summer sausage. I know Hank said he had an awesome snack stick recipe. Like, hands down, awesome. Summer sausage, he said, is a little bit more difficult just because of the nature of it. But, yeah, man, I mean, that's a challenge. Like, that's the same challenge I get from that, trying to make that happen. I get the same satisfaction out of knocking out 10 pounds of brats or sausages as I do actually, you know, bagging the animal. So it's fun, man.
It's good. Multiple rewards.
Yep, for sure. But yeah, it's funny, man, that, you know, because everybody's kind of got their own knack, and I'm to the point to where I'm like grinding up stuff that I'd normally cook for steaks just because it's like, what can I do now?
Yeah, my thing is I love like Greek recipes, and I love Greek kebab, and I like taking turkey breast or even nice, really nice cuts of ham, of the hams, and kebabbing it. And in the kebab chunks and grill. I'm a big griller, so, like, you know, grilling game is risky, and it can be a risky endeavor.
But
that's what I like to do, is put a nice Greek marinade on some good hog ham kebab or venison kebab off the hams, or I'm not a big roast guy. If you're leaving it to become a roast, I'll try to cut it up into kebabs.
In theory, you know, I mean, it's kind of, roast is good on occasion, but kebab, I think, is one of those, like you're saying, you stick simple meat on a grill with veggies and stuff, man, it's hard to beat. It really is. I mean, I think that's where some people kind of get too crazy with game, is they try to do too much.
Mm-hmm.
And that sometimes you can.
Yeah, I mean, it's tough to beat just a venison backstrap, salt and pepper on the grill.
Yeah.
Kind of flash both sides a little bit and slice it thin. You're good to go.
Yep, for sure, man. I agree 100%. Goodness. Not to jump back from fishing, but what's the most memorable fishing venture you've been on, man?
Fishing adventure or fishing?
Fishing trip, I should say. Adventure, pursuit, whatever.
I've been fortunate to go on a lot of places and catch a lot of fish, but
you got one that maybe went south.
That went south.
Yeah.
Well, I'm trying to think. Unfortunately, I got no real tragedies or breakoffs. I've, as far as good ones, salt water in Belize for a honeymoon is kind of hard to beat. Catching my own fish and permit. and then before that, 2 days after I proposed, I went to Alaska alone for 4 weeks. And just spent the time solo floating rivers and camping and fishing. And guided my dad for 2 weeks of that as well.
Nice.
As far as going south, probably this is a combo fish hunt trip. And this is part of Alaska this year. This just happened. So after the caribou hunt, we ended up getting up there early, getting in early, getting flown out early. We had planned on waiting 3-4 days and just fishing for grayling around the airstrip, but weather in Alaska windows were never kind of wasted or always taken advantage of. So when we got up to the area we were going to fly from, they're like, "You ready to go today?" And we were like, "Sure." So we went ahead and got in. Anyway, we got out quick. I've taken Dad on a few different float trips in Alaska, multi-day on our own. And he was like, "Well, maybe now we can do a float trip. I'd love to do another float trip." So I arranged a raft and found a plane and got us flown into a river called Lake Creek.
Mm-hmm.
And it's an amazing river. I'd never paddled it before. I've paddled in class 5 whitewater all over the world, pretty used to whitewater. And there are some whitewater fishes on this, and I knew that. But it was pouring rain. We lost a day for rain. The day we flew in, it was raining pretty hard, but the visibility was a little better. Spent the whole first day in the rain. We were catching rainbows and grayling. And the next day, the sun came out. Catching same more rainbows, grayling, eagles, moose. There's some brown bear. It's having a great float. Third morning, found a wonderful pod of fresh silver salmon. Just hammered some silvers. Got amazing underwater photography and GoPro footage and stuff I've been waiting for years to shoot. That afternoon, we were coming around a bend in the raft and saw second or third of what had been some big rapids that already run and come around, and I just kind of didn't scout and just kind of eyeballed it. Long story short, and it's gonna be a long story anyway, but next thing we know, we found ourselves broached in the raft in the middle of this class 4 rapid. Dad in the front, me in the back, and I'm yelling to him to get over to the side. He's not very experienced in whitewater or rafting like this. And anyway, boat capsizes.
Oh, no.
So Dad's under it. I have one arm on him. I get him out from underneath the raft and swimming, trying to control himself while we're swimming through this rapid in this canyon, and get him to shore, get the raft to shore, while watching just countless gear floating away. Nobody else with us, totally alone.
And stuck.
So basically, yeah, I got the raft flipped. It's probably off adrenaline. Dad calmed down and water out of his waders, and we assessed what we had, and we had no bear spray, no weapon, no lost our fly rods, lost about $12,000 worth of gear.
Oh my god.
So, wow.
Multiple cameras, even lost the damn fish that we had in the boat for dinner.
Oh no.
And worse, we only had an oar left.
Oh god.
And a half, and the top half of another one. spent the next 6 hours lining and hiking and trying to maneuver the raft with one oar down through this 14 miles of canyon. Got to a point where we could camp, ride in heavy brown bear trails, had dry gear, had an Orion prototype in the strapped into the frame, had food, lost all of our fuel, but found a bottle downstream during the course of getting downstream that had pinned in a fallen tree. Got dry clothes on, made dinner. Next morning, luckily I always carry this buck. They call it the PBS, portable butcher shop. It's called Alpha Crosslock, and it's got a saw on it. Next morning, got up and I sawed some trees down with forks in them to make oars, and then I put sleeping bags, stuff sacks over the fork to make a blade.
Mm-hmm.
And rode our butts the last 14 miles out of there.
Wow. And not having a bear spray would have made me a bit nervous.
Yeah.
Without a weapon as well. I mean, that is,
yeah, it's, you know, it's certainly, but what's he going to do? I mean,
yeah.
So, nervous. You know, we were a few days before scheduled pickup, and, there was a lodge boarding up their windows, closed for the season as we come floating down and hit the mouth of the river. And told them what had happened, and they brought us out a couple beers and satellite phone and called the air service, and they came and picked us up, and we took our butts to a bar in Anchorage, and then we went fishing.
Right.
went to the store the next day, bought some more fly rods. We had a week left, and we went and caught some trout. So,
there you go, man.
So that was definitely one that went south.
You'll never forget it.
Never forget it. I haven't written that story yet. I might write about that soon, but that was the short version. But yeah, that was definitely a not a super pleasant memory, but a lot of lessons learned there.
Something you can look back on years now, later, and just kind of be like, oh my God.
Yeah. Now, how lucky were we there? You know, it could have easily gone way.
Yes. Yes. Count your blessings and try to write off as much humor as possible from it.
Yeah.
Yeah. For sure.
Oh, man. But, well, man, I think we're pretty much kind of starting to run out of time. So, you know, you're always more than welcome. You know, we try to have everybody, you know, back on the show, and you're definitely more than welcome for some later episodes. Maybe we can touch back
a little
bit later on in the year. And
anytime. I'm gonna be at the Tennessee SCI banquet this weekend.
Mm-hmm.
With the Ryan Coolers, and then my wife still works for a company in Vermont, so we're gonna go up there. I'm gonna try to go on a snow goose hunt here in the week of the 23rd.
That's right, when I'm going.
Yeah, in New York, and I'll be around doing something. So you guys have good luck as the waters thaw and fish start swimming around and turkey season gobbling.
Oh, yeah, man. It's about to get crazy, which is good. And then it's about to get hurry up, come fall.
Right.
So, all right, man. Well, it was good talking to you guys. Damon, right. Great to have you on the show.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Joe, always good talking.
Likewise.
All right, man. It was good talking. You too. Enjoy, I guess, Joe, your brown trout coming up, and enjoy the upcoming snow goose hunt. Like, I'm going to do the same, Damon. And everybody, thanks for listening again.
Thanks a lot. Appreciate it. Best of luck.
Thank you, Sean.
All right, everybody. Once again, thank you for listening. The support that we have gotten has been more than we would have ever imagined. I don't want to call you fans. I would prefer to call you friends, hunting buddies, hunting partners, friends in the outdoors. So, you are appreciated more than you'll ever know. We would also like to thank our friends in the outdoors, partners, one could say, Banded, Lethal, Puddle Set, Vortex Optics, Wolf Premium Oils, Weston Supply, and Remington Arms. Those people all make this very much so possible. So thank you very much. Check them out. You can find them on our website. You can find them
find them on their websites. The music, the intro, Mr. Frank Turner. The song is called Oh Brother. It is off the album A Tape Deck Heart. I love it. You should love it. Check it out if you haven't. I'm not sure what you're doing. The outro, same thing. So we'd like to say thanks to him. Look forward to his new stuff. And that's pretty much it. So thank you for your support. And it is almost spring turkey season, so I'd like to say to everybody, happy hunting, and hopefully continued success in all of your pursuits to the plate. Take care. Thanks.